Say yes to new beginnings.
Yes.
Say yes to new standards of excellence.
Yes.
Say yes to engaging reportage with a difference.
Yes.
Introducing Yes International Magazine. The time to say yes to your dreams and aspirations is here.
How does it feel to be in the limelight for decades?
Oh, as in, sometimes you wish you were not there. Sometimes you wish you were not there. You know, like, there are people who, like, for instance, you want to eat bola fish. As I remember one time when you wrote, I yabbed myself, Dolly Nachuku, and Liz Nelson for eating abacha. I'm coming to skin. We were young actors then, and we were eating our abacha and cabin biscuit because that was what we could afford at this time.
That's true.
Although the world saw us as big stars because we had done jobs as big people, but we knew the truth about us, that what we could afford at that time was abacha and cabin biscuit. We also knew that you, if you caught us, was going to write about it the following day. What did we care? We were prepared for it. We had a beautiful time, right? We had a beautiful time. So, you know, the truth is, when you are in the limelight, you should just know that the world is watching you. The beautiful thing about knowing that the world is watching you is that you too begin to watch yourself. You begin to be careful the way that you react to things because people are sincerely learning from you. So staying a star for decades, and you know, achieving stardom is easy. One job and you can achieve stardom. But maintaining stardom, that is the cocoa. Because there are people who think that they are stars, and they walk into certain places, and not that people don't recognize them, but the things that comes with stardom does not follow the recognition. Respect is very important. When you walk into a place and people just don't recognize you, but they respect you for the jobs that you have done. Sometimes you don't know them, but you have to sincerely learn to stay humble. You see, that humility and integrity as an actor, don't play with it. People don't care how much you have. They don't care how many jobs you have done, but they care about how you carry yourself because they think that you represent them. So you have to be that. You know, it takes a lot of humility and discipline to be a star and to remain a star.
Interesting. Now, which of your roles would you describe as your worst?
Which of my roles?
Yes.
I don't know. I can't even remember. But I know that I've done a few jobs. You know, when we were starting, some scripts were not exactly very good. But now your friend, they do the film. So your friend comes and begs you, please help me, blah, blah, blah. And, you know, you just do it and you walk away. But I can't even remember their titles because you remember, too, at that time, we were working with working titles. So we didn't even know what the titles... Oh, goodness me. We didn't even know what the titles of the movies were going to be. They give you a working title. And then when it's released, it's a different title. We didn't have social media, so we didn't also know what went into promoting those jobs. We just did our job, got our money when we were paid. When we were not paid, we got the thank you. Well, we didn't get the thank you. We got the relationship. We built friendship. We built brotherhood and sisterhood, and we went on. So I don't remember, but I remember. I don't even know what the title is, but I remember this particular job that we did. We shot somewhere very close to Badagry, and I didn't know the head and the tail of the script. They gave me sides instead of the full script, so I never read the full script. I didn't know what the full script was. When eventually they released, I don't remember the title, Azu. When they released it, I didn't see where I fit into the story. When I was watching the movie, I was like, how did I get into this story? I look like a sore thumb. It didn't connect at all. So that was when they now said, well, they took it to the marketer, and the marketers had insisted that they must go and look for that to shoot for them. At the time, they called that selling faces. So he needed a selling face and shot those bits. But it was ridiculous because it was not connected at all. I don't remember what it's called.
Well, interesting, interesting. Now, you served in the government at some point. Mm-hmm. I'd like you to share your experience with us.
Government in this country is designed not to work. So if you work in government, you must prepare for one of two things. Serve and live with your honor intact. Serve and lose your entire integrity. Make your choice. Either ways, it will work. However, my time in government provided me the knowledge and skill that I needed in dealing with people. Because what I do today, majorly, acting for development or entertainment for development that I do today, I got from my dealings with young people, because I served as SA youth to the governor of River State. I realized that there was a gap that needed to be filled up. There was a disconnect between the people, especially young people, and government. And I was in that gap. That service taught me also administration. I learned how to write briefs. I learned how to respond to briefs. I learned how to raise memos. So it was a learning time for me, because when I went into government, don't forget, I got into Nollywood fresh from university graduation bash, pretty young girl, went into government straight from Nollywood, didn't have a background of what was happening in politics or anything, but got into government. So it was also a learning time for me. However, I'm a quick learner, and it didn't take long before I realized what I needed to succeed, and that what I needed to succeed was to concentrate on the young people that my office was in charge of. And I focused on that and designed programs to accommodate them. So my business was to develop concepts and how to implement them, monitor and evaluate them, respond to the governor's request on youth development, and interact and interface with young people and development agencies and multinationals, NDAs, in charge of youth development. Basically, my work was just around youth and creating jobs for them, helping them find careers and all of that, which I successfully did. But I will tell you one sad thing about government. If you have 27 persons who need to take a decision, and they do not understand you because they are politicians. They understand the political part of what you say, not the development part of what you say. And they all do not vote yes. Let's say, for instance, I say, I want to build a school, for instance. And we say, vote. And 25 of the people there now say, but we have school now. that's your proposal, no matter how important the school is, will be KIV, keep is you. So that's why I say government is designed to fail, because a lot of people in offices do not understand the mandate of their offices, do not understand the things that are important, and so would rather opt for photo ops than proper service to humanity. So I end my case with my matter.
All right. Now, what was your biggest takeaway from your time, you know, in government?
There is a gap that needs to be filled, and if government is not filling it, you as private sector, you as private citizen who can, must fill that gap. If you don't fill that gap, the poor that you neglect today will be your destruction tomorrow. And I'll explain, that's my takeaway. Let me explain that to you, Azu. You may be able to send your child to King's and Queen's Academy of Owanini, anywhere you like, right? This poor man's child is in the ghettos, not in school. Tomorrow, next tomorrow, when your child is done, your child is going to come back to a society with a majority of people who do not have his training. Who do you think will be in trouble? Those of them that have the good education that are in the minority, or those of them with no education that are in the majority? So you will keep having a gap. So it's important that anybody who can must constantly bridge that gap to protect our tomorrow. Otherwise, you wake up one morning and there is no tomorrow.
Wow, interesting. Interesting. Lately, you know, I've noticed that you seem to be paying more attention to activism. What prompted that?
Service in government, though. Service in government. But before service in government, you know, even as an undergraduate, I was an activist, and that was what a lot of people knew me for, even in school. Before then, as a child, I was taught to always speak up. If I didn't agree with a thing, I was advised not to be quiet and not to cry over it, but to talk about it, to say this is right or wrong. Always speak my truth. It didn't matter whether I got flogged at the end of the day or I got pampered, but I must speak my truth as politely as possible, always. Which is why you would hardly hear me curse out. No, I will not, but I will speak up firmly too. But serving in government and seeing how government is run, it's important for everybody to know that somebody must speak up. Somebody must cover up this gap. And that's what has prompted it. We need government to have things working. Yes, government will not be in charge of all of it. But if government does not create an enabling environment, if we do not have policies that are implementable, if we do not have people that we can hold accountable, then nothing will happen. And in this case, for us as a country, as Nigerians, when you look at the main instrument that is used in governance, which is our constitution, and you see all the gaps, deliberate lacunas, all over the place, you know that there is need for you to keep speaking up until that thing is thrown away and a new one is put together. Or, you know, they just realize that this is why we are drowning. Our constitution is a fraud, as well. So we have to keep speaking. It's not the people that are fraudulent. It is our constitution that is a fraud. Our constitution is a fraud. Our constitution is corrupt. That's just it. So, and I think that God has put me in a place where He has also given me power, power of fame and love, power of respect and acceptance. So I must use that, and that's what I'm using, to keep speaking for those who do not have that power.
All right. Now, I need you to tell us, what are the new things, you know, happening in the life of Hilda, watching America, Tokubo?
Plenty. You do know that I've set up a school, so I'm running that. I'm in school myself. I'm reading.
Let's start from there.
I'm in school, so let's keep that in the cooler so that, you know, when we were growing up.
Not the school we are attending. I mean, you said...
Unilag. Unilag. I'm in school. I'm in Unilag. I'm in school. Well, I'm running two schools at the same time. One is online. What school abroad? I'm in neurolinguistics now. So I do coaching for people, and I do analysis, mind analysis for people. Then I'm still a mother, don't forget. So I'm still looking after children. I'm still an actor, so I still get time to go and act. I'm an entrepreneur. I've always been. I'm an unnamed, so I learned to buy and sell. You know, my mother is an evil woman, so I learned how to buy and sell. I'm still buying and selling. Yeah, so there's a lot going on, really. A lot of a bit of everything. But I'm still in the art.
All right. Now, you attended the government school in Port Harcourt. What fond memories of your days in the school do you still remember?
Plenty. As a secondary school girl, a young teenage girl, I was part of the dramatic and debating society of my school. I started representing my school from Form 1. I didn't attend class. When we were in secondary school, it was called Form. So I had a great time. I loved what we called cross-country. Cross-country is like jogging. You jog from your school to another school, and then that school will join you. It was such a beautiful time. I was part of the Sailors Club. We went to an island called Isaka every weekend, and then we will have these long swimming sessions in the Isaka Ocean. And, you know, like, great moments. I'm part of Girls Guide. I still am a guide, even now, you know, so... Oh God, growing up in Port Harcourt and attending Harbour Road is lit. You know, as children will say today, was so cool. we were the cool kids. It was so cool. And too many fun moments. Those moments when you would stand and debate and run spelling quiz, grammar quiz, Bible quiz. Those were my best moments. Oh. And I enjoyed every bit of it.
All right. Now, from there, you know, you proceeded to the University of Port Harcourt, where you studied the theater arts. What was life like at Uniport back then?
You know, I don't know whether to say at the time that we were in Uniport. Uniport was the Harvard of theater arts in Nigeria.
I like that.
Yes, Uniport was the Harvard of theater arts in Nigeria. If you attended Uniport as theater at that time, you were proud of you. In fact, you were arrogant about it. And you would tell everybody, I'm a graduate of Performing Arts Uniport. You said it with so much pride. And you know, our department was not performing arts. It was not dramatic arts. It was called creative arts. So we were very arrogant about it, very, very arrogant about it. We had the best of lecturers. We had people who taught us how to be professionals. So we didn't just learn book, you know, like some schools will teach you all the theories in the world and teach you all the literary analysis, blah, blah, blah. Uniport will teach you the arts, the science, the craft, and the business. So when you get out of Uniport, you proudly tell everybody, I'm a graduate of creative arts. And then you had the opportunity of mixing with other schools via NUTAF and via private sessions. As a student, if you were creative enough and you were business savvy, you could run shows in school even as an undergraduate. Your lecturers will support you. They will support you to build that business part of you when we were in school. Just ready your mind to walk three times. Walk your walk as a student, walk your walk as a director, and walk your walk as a business person, which I think prepared most of us today, most of us who graduated about that time, prepared us for life and made us who we all eventually are today. There's hardly anyone who graduated from Uniport around that period who is not a successful somebody today. So,
All right. Now, talking about your lecturers, you know, back then at Uniport, of all the lecturers, you know, that taught you, who left the most indelible mark?
This person started leaving marks in my life from when I was age 7. Her name was Amatsu Braid. She has gone to be with God. But I can't stop talking about her. It would almost be impossible to write my life story without writing about Amatsu Braid. The next person would be Professor Olarotimi for teaching me how to always step out of my comfort zone as an actor. For daring me to be everybody at the... You know, one of my best performances, Orogolo, was actually written for a male. It was not a female character. For a male. And we had less than a week to go on for a show when he cancelled a previous show and introduced this and made me Orogolo. And I had like the most lines. It was the most... I don't even know how anybody can take that kind of risk on another person. He took that risk, gave me a male role, and I had less than 1 week to have a performance. Not just a regular performance, but a performance up for competition. That's all I wrote to me. And he was also my project supervisor, because my major was not acting, my major was writing and directing. So he was my project supervisor. And because he was also dean of faculty, he handed me over to another lecturer, Emmanuel Oga. And these three people, and Columbus Irisanga, I don't even know where to put them. There's no hierarchy. You know, Columbus Irisanga, Emmanuel Oga, I don't know where to put them, but these are the people who affected my life positively, and I will be eternally grateful to them.
Wow, interesting. Now, Hida is from Buguma. She was also born there.
I was born in Port Harcourt. I was born in Port Harcourt.
Okay, from Buguma, born in Port Harcourt. So how often does Hida go home? How often does Hida visit there?
Okay, so as a child, I went home twice in the year. June, which we call Centenary, Buguma Centenary, and Christmas, okay, which they make you go as a child. You had no opinion in the decision. It was entirely your parents' decision. As a child, they used to split it between Umuahia and Buguma. Growing up, all the time that I was in Lagos, I went to Buguma only once, which was the day before Christmas. And then on the 27th, I would leave Christmas and go on. As a mother, I don't know how many times I went to Buguma.